Today we're meeting Kia Höök. Kia Höök is a professor in human-machine interaction at Stockholm University. And for many years, Kia has been researching affective computing with her colleagues at her lab. And of course, she's the ideal person to ask about affective computing. So, Kia, what is affective computing?
So the original vision for affective computing was that it would be interesting to try and recognize what our users are experiencing when they're interacting with systems, their emotional responses to the interaction, and then make like a model of that and use that to modify the interaction, perhaps to create for new emotional experiences or to fix problems, like if a user is really frustrated or something, then maybe the interaction needs to be adapted and changed. So it really came out of artificial intelligence, a very sort of strong idea of the possibility to understand people and to bring in emotion as one of those things that we should understand in the system. But since then, this is a while ago. It's really a book by Rosalind Picard in 1998 that sort of really established the term. Mm-hmm. There was work going on before that as well, but that really established the term. And since then, of course, a lot of things have happened, and there are like several branches within this and perhaps modification to the sort of original vision.
Mm-hmm. Could you describe those different branches?
Yeah, so there's one branch that sort of takes perhaps a critical view on whether it's possible to know what somebody else's emotion is just by looking at their face or their bodily gestures or putting sensors on your body to recognize your sort of physical reactions to emotion, because people are interesting and complex beings, and maybe we can't reduce what we experience to a few variables that mm-hmm. we can measure.
Is that your direction or your branch?
Yeah. So I think for me and some of the people I've been working with, it's interesting to think about emotion more in terms of something that you can add to an interaction, but you don't necessarily model it and represent it in the system, and you don't necessarily adapt the interaction in such a way that users become extremely frustrated because the system does things based on perhaps like, now I smile, mm-hmm. though maybe I'm not that happy, maybe I'm a little bit nervous because I'm in an interview situation, and if the system would, because I'm smiling, start to interact with me in a new way, not recognizing the complexity of the situation, then I would hate that system.
Yeah.
So in my sort of direction, people have been sort of saying, we should not reduce people to a few variables, and emotion is really at the core of what we are and how we experience the world. And so reducing that to a facial expression or gestures or whatever is not only very difficult, but it's also a stupid thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Could you put a name on this direction? Do you have a name yet?
Yeah, so Phoebe Sengers and me and some other people talk about this as affective interaction mm-hmm. rather than affective computing, mm-hmm. sort of putting a more emphasis on that it's not the system, the computer, that thinks that it knows what your emotion is, that it has this model inside that is computing your emotion, but instead that that it's an interaction where emotion is constructed and interpreted and given meaning mm-hmm. as in a dialogue between the user and the system, or between users through a system.
Mm-hmm.
After a while, instead of working in opposition against affective computing, I think we just discovered, oh, there are so many interesting applications that we can build.
Mm-hmm.
And we can use some of the same technologies and some of the same insights perhaps on what emotion is. But build other kinds of systems. So now I wouldn't say that it's working in opposition, it's more working, you know, in a constructive way, mm-hmm. finding mm-hmm. other kinds of applications. So on the one hand, we have the affective computing mm-hmm. group, the AI people mm-hmm. who are really interested in modeling emotion for recognizing users' emotions and for generating interaction. And then we have this affective interaction group with where we're looking at more emotion as a constructed process, as something where we create meaning between ourselves, and where probably the system does not, definitely not, know more about you than you do yourself. But then in general, I would say, you know, it's kind of stupid to say that this is a new thing, because of course we've always been designing with emotion in mind. You know, musicians, poets, writers, filmmakers have always been sort of working with the interaction between what they produce and how people react to that emotionally. Of course, when you turn to computers and interaction with computers, then interaction happens over time, and you can explicitly sort of work with the what the user does and how the system responds and so on. And that is new and different, but a lot of people have been doing beautiful IT designs for a long time. And I think people like Don Norman picked up on that when he talks about emotional design.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that's, you know, just to put a bit of a perspective on it and not to say, oh, suddenly in 1998 we discovered emotion.
Yeah, yeah. Could you tell us about the theoretical background for your school and the other schools as well?
So I think affective computing, as it was envisioned by Ross Picard at MIT, was very much built on cognitivism of a certain kind, and a lot on neurological sort of biologism, you know, while the perspective that Phoebe Sangers and I and others have had is more of constructivism, phenomenology, looking at people as being in the world, and that the tools are part of us and part of our expression, rather than this is me and the system is looking at me, recognizing stuff in me and doing stuff on behalf of me. So those are perhaps, that's simplifying of course, but perhaps sort of the two paradigms and the backgrounds they have.
Can you name some different products which we can see come from the different directions?
So in affective computing, they worked with, for example, Rosalind Picard's group at MIT Media Lab have been working with both learning applications and with autistic children,
mm-hmm.
and their learning of emotional communication. They also worked with health issues of various kinds. So an example, for example, is for autistic children, recognizing somebody else's facial expression is difficult, mm-hmm. and they don't understand necessarily the emotional, what the emotion is, what it is,
sure.
that they're seeing. And so their idea is that by simplifying this and by putting a recognition system on other people that the kid is interacting with,
mm-hmm.
looking at their faces and then simplifying the facial expression into this is a happy person, and this is somebody who's getting angry and so on, they can actually learn rules for, okay, hang on, this person is now getting angry. I didn't see that, but now I understand that when this person has this particular expression, then that actually means anger.
Mm.
Now I need to watch out, you know. So this one is actually putting a camera on top. So I think what they did, I don't know what the system is looking like today, but when I saw the system last, it was, you have a hat on,
mm-hmm.
and there's a camera pointing to the person you're interacting with, and it's doing in real time, analyzing the facial expression of that person, simplifying that into a symbol like happy, angry,
mm-hmm.
whatever, and so that the kid can interact with this in real time.
Are there any problems in this approach?
There are many interesting problems. So I think on the one hand it's fantastic because autistic children have a lot of problems because they just don't understand what is going on. Why did that person become so angry now?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't see the little signs and signals that things are going in the wrong direction. On the other hand, some of them feel like, why do we always have to adapt to the normal people?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like this and you know. And so ethically, I think Ross has been doing a really good and interesting argument about how do we deal with that? Should we always make people who have disabilities adjust to the normal way of being?
Mm-hmm. Or, very interesting, yeah.
Yeah. And also, of course, simplifying facial expressions like that. It's because a lot of the time we are behaving in ways that are socially acceptable. So you don't show your frustration or anger, or you try to hide it, to mask it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the question is, what is really going on? Is somebody, you know, if you're masking frustration or anger, so you have on top of that, you have a happy face and then there's anger underneath. What is the, you know, what is it that the kids should be learning from this? Mm-hmm.
So you are in your direction, you're trying to design something which is not simplifying things as much, I guess.
Yeah.
But can we see that in any products now?
So in our group, we built several systems where we try to sort of work more with emotion as an expression. It's not something for you to recognize, but I'm expressing something and I'm explicitly trying to communicate something to you. So we've worked with bodily expressions, for example, because emotion is really interesting. It's like sitting in between our social interaction and in our bodies and in the whole sort of interaction back and forth. So if I want to express that I'm interested in talking to you in this interview, you see, I lean forward, mm-hmm. I open my eyes, I smile, I actively construct for an interaction,
mm-hmm.
and you respond to that. You smile back at me.
I don't lean forward because then I'll
be like in this. Front of the camera.
So that's why I'm holding back.
But it's contagious, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like I do this, and you feel like, oh, I should be responding to
definitely.
This. So between ourselves, we are constructing an experience. So one of our systems we built for the mobile phone was that instead of sending text messages only.
Mm-hmm.
You have a pen that has sensors in it. So you write your text message, perhaps saying, I'm so happy for you that you have this wonderful interview today or something. And then you do a gesture and you can do like a happy gesture or you can do a sad, depressed, hard inwards gesture or you can do angry gestures or whatever.
Mm.
And that changes the background of the text message. So there will
be... Automatically.
Yeah. And there will be colors and shapes and animations. So if I do the happy, there will be champagne, bubbly, nice red colors. If I do the angry, there will be ragged little angry things jumping around. So, and this is what I send to you. Okay, so it's not that I'm expressing necessarily what I'm feeling right now, or the truth of what I'm experiencing. I'm actually constructing a message for you that where I want to influence you, perhaps,
mm-hmm.
or I want to express something of my own. So if I'm saying, you know, good for you that you're doing an interview today, happy gestures, I might at the same time be hangover from the conference dinner yesterday and I don't want to communicate that, right? So this is what we do in social communication.
Mm-hmm.
We construct what we want to convey. And so with this pen, you actually construct. At the same time, you get into the experience. So if I do a happy gesture and I'm writing a happy message and the colors are happy and there's champagne bubbly things, that actually creates for an experience in the moment,
mm-hmm.
an affective loop, if you want to perhaps frame it like that, that sort of makes the experience of what you're trying to express stronger.
Yeah.
So that's an example
mm-hmm.
of a system that we built.
Personally, I don't know that product.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any products on the market which are really popular or well-known?
Mm. Not that many, and perhaps that's not so strange given that the field is fairly young.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of products that sort of have these kinds of insights in there anyway, without having learned from researchers, and maybe that is a fairly common thing.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the V-mode that you use when you play games.
Mm-hmm.
For some of the games, the gestures are really there and they're designed to pull you into particular experiences. So I guess that's a good example.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for this first part of the interview.
Thank you.
Let's head on for the next one.
Okay.
And if you want to get some direct guidelines about how you can apply it, you should watch our second video with Kia. And if you want to know even more, you should also read her chapter, which you can find at interactiondesign.org. And here you can also find more chapters and videos like this one with other thought leaders and inventors. Thank you so much for watching. Hope you enjoyed it.